Electric vehicle sales in India have seen a sudden spurt, especially over the last 1 year, and are set to see a further boom, what with the revisions in the recent FAME II incentive scheme. We are in conversation today with top leadership at Ather Energy. Tarun, Ravneet, thank you so much for joining us and taking out time to speaking with us.
Thank you for coming.
Tarun, I want to ask you, you've been on an expansion spree, especially over the last 6 months. So what does it feel like?
Absolutely amazing. This is why you started, right? So the last 6-8 months have been terrific. We were present in like 2 cities back in November last year, and now we are present in 13. And there are like 20, 30 more cities in the pipeline next 6 months. I think it's an amazing feeling. What felt like a prototype journey last year that now suddenly feels like very real, because people across the country are buying the product, they're using it, they're talking about it, they care about it. I think it's amazing.
Ravneet, I want to understand, how is this franchisee model working out for you guys, and what sort of investments go into creating such a setup like you have created one in Delhi here?
So I think, as you're aware, we started with a company-owned COCO model, right? But given the ambition we have for scale-up and the speed at which we want to scale up, we just believe that a dealer retail partner model is just more amenable to a faster scale-up, right? So we have our own experience centers in Bangalore and Chennai. Delhi is the third one, but this is more of an exception now, what used to be a rule earlier. Now, as we go forward, we work with our retail partners across every city, and every city has its own bunch. And we mentioned about scale-up, going to about 50 to 100 cities. That's going to be on the back of a retail partner model. And that's working really well. Partners are coming on board. We have tier one partners across every city that we are present in. And they're happy to invest in, because they also understand that if we have to grow this business, it has to be grown in a, different from the way traditional automotive has, at least from a scooter perspective, right? Where you can't just put 2 scooters on display and hope to sell it, right? It needs a lot of investment in terms of not money investment, but energy investment in education, in how you sell, the experience you create, the ambience you create, which is what we do now. So all the experience centers that are coming up will conform to the model that you see today, irrespective of whether Ather owns it or our partners own it. From an investment perspective, it's about a store like this, which is about 1600 to 1800 square feet, would typically cost about, I'd say about 80 lakhs to a crore to set up and one time. Of course, OPEX is different from city to city.
What growth challenges do you see in the electric vehicle space, and especially for Ather as well now, because a lot of competition is coming up? And what is your short-term and the long-term growth outlook?
I think the biggest challenge now is adding more capacity. There is a ton of demand for electric vehicles from all over the country. We are adding more and more touch points. We're adding more stores, experience centers everywhere. And the biggest bottleneck now is scaling up production, especially scaling up our supply chain, right? You, it's not just about our capacity. It's also about our suppliers and their vendors and their partners' capacity. So that's the number one focus, making sure that we can increase that number 20, 30, 40x over the next year or two. So I think over the next 5 years, with the new subsidy support and everything that we have, I believe as much as 40, maybe even 50% of the Indian scooter market can go electric. The primary constraint will be how many products and how much capacity we have, right? But otherwise, from a pure demand perspective, from a pure customer's willingness to change perspective, I believe almost half of the market will be ready to go electric in the next 5 years.
Ravneet, would you agree what Tarun is saying? And what would be your outlook for the EV market going forward?
Very much so. I think, the issue, we believe, whether we get to 45 or 50 or 55 or whatever number, isn't going to be because on account of consumer demand. I think there are enough people and demand is growing. We see in the market, there's enough buzz in the market. People understand why they should go electric. People are bought into the idea of electric, right? The only constraint is our ability as an industry to scale up, which is a combination of manufacturing capacity, supply chain, players coming in, etc. If the supply side is sorted, I don't think there's anything that stops us from reaching half or more in the next 5 years.
Ather plays in a very niche category. And now with the revisions in the FAME II incentive scheme, do you think that a lot of fly-by-night operators are also mushrooming up and kind of denting the image around EVs?
I don't really think so. I think the new FAME II that's been there for the last 2-3 years now is pretty clear. And has pretty strict localization norms, So you've got to have a supply chain that is domestic. You've got to have good product performance, minimum top speed of I believe 40 or 50 kilometers per hour, a minimum range of 80 kilometers. I think these are really good benchmarks, and they fundamentally prevent fly-by-night or bad faith operators from coming in. I'm sure there'll be a few exceptions here and there, but those are exceptions rather than the rule now.
Ravni, talking about localization, so I believe Ather 450X is already at 90% localization presently. So going forward, do you intend to increase that further?
Actually, we are 99, so I don't know where we go from here. So the only thing we import today are the cells, because there is no option locally available. But pretty much everything already is localized, so there is no headroom to grow there. So given the strong intent that the government has shown through PLI and other schemes that are in play, they have just been announced. And given the fact that setting up a facility for sales is a very large investment, so you would imagine that large players will jump in, right? So a bunch of them in the country. So I think in the next 3 to 5 years, we should see, you know, there is a capex side to it, and there is just a scale up and build side to it, right? And both are sort of time intensive and money intensive. But I guess in the next 3 to 5 years, we should see some local production coming out of India.
Now, Ather has also heavily invested into charging infrastructure. You've been setting up chargers and charging infra before entering the market and launching a product in that particular market. So, you know, going forward, as you're saying that, you know, you want to expand further into 100 cities. So is that plan going to continue?
The model will remain the same. And the reason we have done that always is before you decide to buy an Ather product in your city, we want to give you the comfort and the confidence that Ather is invested in and Ather is present here for good, right? We are not fly by night, right? We put up our infrastructure even before you bought the first vehicle, right? So that's been the plan always, which is why whether it is 3 chargers, 10 chargers, 15 chargers, we'll have a few chargers before any vehicle sold out of the city. And that plan won't change even as you go to 100 cities.
Ravni, independent companies like Tata Power are also coming into the charging infrastructure space. So do you think the time has come for a common charging standard for India?
Very important aspect of any infrastructure business is interoperability. If you don't have that, then you have islands of solutions which are never great for industry, right? Because nobody's going to be profitable. So unfortunately, today from a two-wheeler perspective, there is no standard that's been defined, at least from a connector perspective, right? We've been working with the government the last 2 to 3 years through various bodies like the BIS, TST, etc. You know, trying to arrive at a common solution for at least the two-wheeler side. Cars, of course, there are solutions available. Two-wheeler, there is nothing. Even internationally, there is nothing, right? So that's a very important requirement from a business model perspective. I think the government is fairly committed to solving that problem soon enough. We'll see when that happens, but I think there are very active discussions there. And and once that happens, suddenly the business model changes, right? Because today, if somebody has to set up for, like for example, for us, right? While technically our solution is available to Ather and non-Ather customers, but given the limitations of lack of interoperability, we can't provide the same seamless experience to non-Ether customers, because we technically it's not possible, right? But once there is interoperability, I think the game changes dramatically. It allows players to come in and start making deeper investment than they currently do. A lot of players today make investments in anticipation of a future, so they do basic investments, right? Not really at scale, because they don't know where this is going, right? So that's a critical requirement, and hoping we'll solve for it soon enough.
Tarun, now you're a startup yourself, so going forward, would you be willing to engage with some innovative companies, some startups in the charging infrastructure space?
Not really. We don't know of any company right now, so there's no active plan. And generally, I think we are more focused on building ourselves, at least on the design and the product side. So there are no immediate plans of any acquisitions.
Tarun, talking about manufacturing, you've recently entered into your Hosur facility in Tamil Nadu. So what are some of the advanced manufacturing facilities that you have there, some of the high-tech solutions like Industry 4.0, IoT, that you're deploying there in order to produce the Ather 450X?
I think so. There's been a fair bit of work that's happened on the battery manufacturing and assembly side. A lot of automation to bring down assembly cost, assembly time, and improve overall quality. The overall tag times have come down quite a lot. And that's been down to really solid innovation and automation there. we are still in early stage, but the vehicle assembly itself will see dramatic changes. Industry 4.0 is already there. Data collection from each station is already happening. So that's helping us have solid trackability onto every single system that's coming together. And over the coming years, I think we're going to see increased levels of automation on vehicle assembly itself as each station gets more and more automated. Today, we are rolling out a vehicle every 4 minutes. Eventually, this is going to come down to like 30, 40 seconds. So that 8x improvement is going to be on the back of a lot more automation. But from a data perspective, I think we're already there.
How are you engaging with the supplier belt that is there in Tamil Nadu? Because, you know, you've entered into Hosur in the new plant. So how are you engaging with the supplier belt that Tamil Nadu offers you?
So see, these are existing relationships that we have, right? It's not that with the move to Hosur factory, you have to reestablish all of that. The localization quest that we had has been, it predates the FAME requirement. So while FAME sort of put a deadline to it, but we were committed to it even before FAME came in, which is why we are at where we are, right? So the relationship that we have, or the existing one that we've been working with in the past, and because we also haven't dramatically changed location, we were in Bangalore, now in Hosur. So even from a geographic location perspective, nothing much has changed from earlier to now, right?
Tarun, now the competition is heating up in the electric vehicle space, and formidable players like Ola Electric are also coming up. So how do you plan to combat this assault?
I don't think there's any combating that's going to happen. I think the market needs more credible, more options, more players. So every competition only helps build the market more. And I don't think we are going to look at this from a perspective of how do we combat anybody. I think if we have more OEMs launching more products, that drives better customer awareness, that drives more supplier viability, and that drives more infrastructure. All of it is great to have.